Would you like to start off? I'm keeping it very open so that everybody can introduce themselves and talk about their work, or just read the poems.
Okay. I'm going to do a mixture of both. I'm going to talk and read at the same time. I hope you can hear me. I do have a problem with my voice. I'll just give a bit of background about myself. I started writing when I was first learned how to write as a child. And then when I was in the seventh grade, I had a teacher who loved poetry. And she was actually the first person who said to me, "You could be a writer." And I just fell in love with poetry. I loved the way she recited it. I loved the way that images could convey emotion and pictures. And so I started writing poetry. And I continued writing poetry right through my teenage years. And then I've written it ever since. So it's been the past maybe 55 years that I've written poetry. I was very active at one time in the poetry scene in Ottawa, the city in which I live, and also in Canada. And then I had a book published around 1995, I think it was, and I tend to write thematically. So I don't tend to write individual poems. I have an idea in mind, and I explore that idea. Anyways, I wrote a book in had it published in 1995 called Bodily Presence. And then I stopped writing poetry. I just felt I had nothing more to say. I started having a lot of self-doubt about my ability as a poet. One of the things that did happen to me and influenced my writing very much is I worked for the Canadian International Development Agency, CIDA, and I was traveling very frequently to Africa and other countries in South America and Asia. And so this, when before I stopped writing, this really influenced my writing, because I felt in a way, by going to all these countries, I would sort of say, you know, well, why do I do and think a certain way? Because I'd be talking to local people. And at the same time, I was sort of wondering, well, why do they have these beliefs, or why do they have these customs? So I was constantly questioning. Then in 2003, I had an opportunity to go on a mission, a UNHCR mission, which came to Pakistan, which went to Afghanistan and Iran. And it was the most incredible trip of my life. It was looking at refugees and the refugee situation in these three countries. I started in Pakistan, and I met a gentleman called Zaid Alahi, Roxana Rashid, Sadia Ahmed. I began to learn about this area of the world. I also came across people who had an incredible love for poetry. And this really impressed me. And I would meet people who would quote poetry. I'd be in shops, and they would be quoting poetry. And it made me think, if they feel this strongly about poetry, and they love poetry this much, why am I silencing myself? So in a way, that trip helped me rediscover my voice. So what I want to do is I'm going to read three poems from Aperture, which is a book about that trip. It's largely centered in Afghanistan. I just thought I'd read these three poems, and then I'd read the poems from my head filled with Pakistan and talk about that for a bit. And as I said, the one thing that was interesting with all my trips with CETA, a lot of people for CETA, they come to the capital city. But I was actually able to travel through all these countries and actually meet ordinary people who would talk about their lives. And this has really influenced my writing. This poem is called Marking Time. I saw a boy on a swing near a graveyard, and so I wrote this poem. Marking Time. The boy swings back and forth, a pendulum marking time. His lungs, synchronized with air, inaugurate an arc of song. His hands grasp rough bark, the limb of a pomegranate tree, barren as the land. Behind him, Up a steep incline, shards of tilting rocks mark the graves of Afghans slaughtered over years of discord. Here and there, red cloth, worn by the veneration of wind, oscillates from poles bleached white as the bones of martyrs ensconced. Below, the boy's feet against the fixed point of trunk push him back and forth into space that takes on the context of his sinuous body, to and fro, detonated by an innate rhythm and instinctive delight in his voice. He flies past the scarred landscape toward that opening, his future. The second poem I'm going to read is called Dust. And we had visited a refugee camp, and I was really struck by it. So this is called Dust. These men's faces give back the somber mountains, rising high above this plain. The punishing winds gouging deep divides, barren folds and crevices. The sun's onslaught steeping soil to the pitch of tea. These men and their families, tenacious, scrub brush wedged between layers of shale, eking out lives precarious as their goats dangling over edges, necks craned to tear at lip leaves as they find them. These elders sitting cross-legged in council, the beaten earth below them, plush with rugs textured by tradition, designs of their homeland, ever-present memories of what they have fled, of what has been left. Dervishes of fine powder coat everything. Mouths and throats are intense with dust. Yet one man invokes Allah, the guidance of his wisdom, his voice moist with hope, a spring of water. The stories that pour forth are of terror and oppression, harder than the rocks among which they scratch, coaxing what nourishment they can to feed their children, who stand removed, ravenous for the words of their fathers. Don't forget us, the camp poet pleads. Listen to the wind. Its howl is our voice. It has seized our pain and throws it back at us. We are the dust it scatters here and there, hurting our eyes like the torture that has scarred our bodies. So those are two poems, excuse me, from Aperture. So then for the next 5 years, I came on mission to Pakistan once or twice a year. And again, traveled throughout the country, saw actually quite a bit of every province. What struck me about Pakistan is the vibrancy of the culture. It just, I mean, in the West, we have a certain perception of Pakistan that is very much given to us by the media. The reality I found is partially true, but a whole element of the society is missing. Again, going back, it's that culture. It's that vibrancy of this society that has really impressed me. I would buy books of poetry and I'd go back to Canada and I would read them. I would go to musharas of poetry in Urdu, and although I do not speak Urdu, Saudi very much kindly provided translation. But poetry is also about music, and that's what really struck me again. And being here is a very humbling experience. Here today is a very humbling experience for me. Being sort of with these poets, both young voices and older voices like Waqas, but also going to sessions where Kishwar Naeem and Iftikhar Arif spread, and again, it was in Urdu, I don't understand it. But it's not just their presence, it's also the reaction of the crowd. as if the Kara said today, when he lived in London and he went to the Poetry Center. In North America and England, often poetry readings are maybe 20 people. But it's also the appreciation, the venerance that the audience gives to poet, which makes me feel, again, very humble. The challenge of writing a book such as this is, I don't want to write postcard poetry. You know, I don't want to really just focus on the exotic, because that's really very simple. I don't know whether I have achieved this in this chapbook, which is just a small book. The reason why I have a chapbook is because I'm actually working on a longer term and a larger collection called Where You Dwell, which is a story of my mother's life and death. My mother passed away last June at 104. And she was an amazing person, and she remained very vibrant and very humorous till the very end. And I didn't want to be too divided in terms of my attention, so I wanted to focus on that book. And when I finish that book, which I hope is this year, then I'll return to writing poems about Pakistan, because I can hear them in my head wanting to break out. So I'm going to read a few poems from this book. I used to travel up to Peshawar, which is a city I absolutely love. And we used to go, before they built the new highway, we used to go up the GT road. And I love going through the villages like Meshera and just seeing the reality of people's day-to-day life. Excuse me. So this is called Truck Art Glimpse on the Grand Truck Road. One. Concoction of arabesque calligraphy transforms these brute trucks that lumber, belching fumes, heave and hobble inch by inch up inclines, down declines, freight bulging over the sides, swaying, restrained by stained canvas, belted and puckered like a fat man's shirt. Two. Black metal, the truck center of gravity, illuminated in reds and blues and yellows, hued to purple, green, and orange. The interplay of light, the concurrence, the line of God, mystical ships, the royal regalia, Buddha, geometric paisley, a mango seed. Three. Across one panel, an inscription undulates, its continuum a sacred geometry, leaf motif of symmetry, curved and underlined, spoken or read on the tongue. A guzzle sung, poetry of the beloved, exaltation of the divine. Four. A scorched wind swirls, embroiders the air, dust stitched with flower blossoms, shredded from trees, vines through which the trucks blur, a reverie of color, the quiver of silk when a dancer pivots, silver chains wrapping the wheel rims, bracelets and bells jingle exquisitely across ankles and feet. After I went back to Canada in 2010, Ilona and I edited a Canadian magazine called Vallum, and it was a selection of Pakistani poets writing in English. So I was here in 2013, and it was launched, Ilona and I launched it in Islamabad at Kush Khas, and then in Lahore at Lums. While we were in Lahore, I visited a potter called Scheherazad Alim. Alim? Thank you, Alim. And I wrote this poem following the visit to her house and her studio. It's called I Am the Vessel. The arc of her foot propels the wheel, a planet rotating in orbit. As the cup of her hands draw up the clay anointed with water that yields to the pressure of her thumb, bulges and narrows under her fingers. She conceives fables, reaches back in time through fluid clay, Paleolithic shapes, voluminous vessels, wounds embedded within the skin of pots she then dips and brushes, readies for their passage of fire. Outside, palm shadows across the yard, a concentration of silhouettes are assuaged by the placement of bowls, basins, bottles, luxurious with light, water, and flowers. Their stillness, a refuge, a cleansing, commands homage and trust. Porous, sintered by grief, the chambers of her heart rendered tangible. And I'm just going to read one more poem. I'm going to read the final poem in the book because what happened, I've maintained friendships with many of the people I met in Pakistan, very close friendships. And one night in Ottawa, we had a snowstorm because, as you know, in Ottawa, we get a lot of snowstorms. And I was walking somewhere, and a line came to mind, overnight came a flurry. But what was interesting was the day before, there had been a snow in Islamabad. And when I opened my computer in the morning and went to Facebook and to various emails, there were all these photographs of snow in Islamabad. So this line led to this poem. Overnight came a flurry of photos, snow in Islamabad. The indigo Marlagah Hills backdrop to the city transformed to foliated white marble, a crochet prayer cap. The minutes of Faisal Mosque to shards of an iceberg, while behind Photoshop polar bears, the Supreme Court gleams a glacial mass. Of selfies at Pier Shua, men and women with grins like kids suspended in mid-air as they leap and twirl in the crystal flakes or splay out, create silhouettes in the accumulating drifts. Of Instagrams in the market, where parents toss woolens, jackets, boots aside, search for exact fits for children, and the stalls of Walla sizzle and steam with spicy soups, pakoras, milk froths in cauldrons of tea. Thank you.
Now we have with us Waqas Khwaja, and he has a collection called Hold Your Breath, which just came out, I think, last month, Waqas. Yes. So we're going to follow the same kind of format, and you'll talk about your work and read.
Well, thank you very much, Ilona.
And thank you, Blaine. That was a wonderful reading. Really
enjoyed that very much. I hope you can all hear me. Very briefly, I teach at a small liberal arts college in Atlanta, Georgia. It's called Agnes Scott College. It's a college for women. I've been there 21 years and have published several volumes of poetry. And I've come here especially to introduce my book that has just come out, Hold Your Breath. So I guess that should be introduction enough. I am a professor of literature, I think I mentioned that, and creative writing. Those are the kind of courses I teach, British Romanticism, post-colonial literature, and creative writing, poetry writing in particular. So I'll start with a poem that I wrote in response to the hysteria that we have about Muslims in the West today. And I'll just let the poem speak for me, I think. I wouldn't have written the poem if I had anything else to say. So this is called I'm Afraid of Muslims. I'm afraid of Muslims. Christians unnerve and alarm me. Jews fill me with dread. I fear Hindus. I'm terrified of Gautama's followers, scared of Nanak's devotees. Science and art, secularism and socialism, capitalism, communism, commerce, civilization rattle and dismay me. An ominous firelight flares up in my brain the moment I see a human figure, And I flee in terror to deserts, forests, and hills, to rivers, lakes, and seas, to haunts of birds and beasts, the domains of fish and eels, of sharks, dolphins, and whales, to worlds of insects and worms, of all burrowing creatures, to realms of reptiles, serpents, and snakes. Contiguous worlds, without rituals of aversion, without philosophy, religion, law, without affliction of private visions, where no species inflicts its language on another, no species its lexicon, its call, its order, its practice, where life itself is art, living science, contiguous worlds of simple sorrows, simple joys, without raptures and ecstasies, without gnawing of the vitals in envy and spite, where pain does not devolve to depths of despair, nor killing bloom into calamity no words may adequately contain. Contiguous worlds, now turned into garbage bins, into litter pits, into radioactive disposal dumps, in collective indifference. Contiguous worlds to which malign effluents leach and spread irredeemably, where plants of infections and defilement pitch their roots deep into the earth's core. Contiguous worlds, invaded and annexed, ruptured and torn and robbed. Look, look, I cry out, the stockpiles they have assembled, the toxic malice of their words and deeds, the malevolence of their contempt, the impunity of their depredations, the freedom of their slaughter, oblivious to what is seeded, oblivious to what they foment, unmindful of ruin and havoc, blind to the obliteration they have prepared for themselves. But the plains smile and shake their heads. Deserts stretch out on their backs and snigger. Mountains, caverns, and rocks ring with laughter. And waters of the earth dissolve in wild guffaws. Thank you. Here's a poem I wrote for my father who passed away a few years ago, 4 years ago. I dream of my father. It is as if again I am getting ready to accompany you to a district far away, to assist you in another murder trial, assembling all that may be needed for the journey. Daylight sweeping in as I hear your bright voice in another room asking, "Is it all done? Are we ready?" And the next night, I am at a table at our old place, making sandwiches and packing slices of tea cake, when you enter suddenly. But I, just at that instant, inexplicably, find the sandwiches dwindled, the cake gone entirely, and embarrassed, look about in confusion. They were for you, yes, though it was you always who prepared the sandwiches, got the tea cake you liked. But where did they vanish? Now it would be contemptible to serve you a poor collation when we stop for tea. And there are only two, perhaps three pieces left. Both dreams entering soundlessly my sleep world, one night following another, a month after you passed on. Meaningless, probably, passing apparitions, but I can't get them out of my head. For the days of my apprenticeship with you come back to me, with all the audacity of my youth, the swagger and feigned conviction floated on the dazzling slipstream of your renown, while others just smiled and suffered it for your sake. But case files and travel bags are real. The smooth, milk tea-colored sleeves for legal briefs, nap of worn paper in my palms, the bookish scent of Law Digest, their solemn black and brown binding. Real, too, the smell of fresh baked bread, the rich chicken paste seasoned with cracked black pepper, the lavishly buttered egg spread spiced with mustard, flavored with crushed mint leaves, and you, with your deep resonant voice, your signature smoker's smell, not yet plagued by resentments and disagreements, nor by the clogged arteries or the cancer on your tongue, the warm magnitude of your presence, just as real as sunshine on my face. Okay.
What page is that? Sorry.
26. Well, on the request from Ilona, I'm going to read this poem. This in this book, as in others, I've tried out various forms, and this is one of them. It's a rhymed poem, unusual to find normally in our times, in the times we live. This is called Five Wives I Am Married To. Yes. Five wives I am married to and carry on with a secret lover, devoted to each equally, to all together and separately. But I have neither guilt nor shame for this or that, for one or other, nor care for those who would heap blame like a pail of waste upon my head, curse and damn and wish me dead. Some creed, I'm told, permits only four. Others prescribe monogamy. I care for neither one nor other, nor for 100 milkmaids who dance to delight a god or two. My five mates I will have and keep, though share them with all most willingly. My lover too I do not care if she warms another's bed. She's free to go and sleep with whomsoever she chooses to. Yet when she comes to me and brings her musky flanks, her tulip lips, her spiced breath, my spirit sings. My parched bodyscapes long dead, awaken in 1,000 tiny nibs, alert to her mouth that blows on them, and all at once erupt in bloom, and there in earth's uncloistered room, sound, taste, and smell, taction, and sight, come together in a dithyramb of unpremeditated delight. So here is another. This is a little longish poem, but I'd like to share this with you for the reasons there are times that we live in all across the globe, I suppose, in countries, whether it is in the West or the East, we must never forget, that have all kinds of interdictions and prohibitions for people. It is just a question of what we recognize or what we see on the outside, and people inside may not notice. This is called Yes, They Were My Eyes. Yes, they were my eyes. But first it was the tongue that bothered them. They removed the larynx, and this at least took care of all that uncontrolled, ungoverned talk they heard that so annoyed them. But this was not enough either. The tongue still wagged, even if its words were not very clear. And they thought this was all triggered by what the eyes saw or could see if allowed to have their way. So that's when, keeping them wide open, they drilled through the cornea, and when even that did not quite allay their anxiety, they had to find other means to prevent what wasn't supposed to be seen even as a clouded image. So they scooped them out and preserved them in a bottle they then gave me to carry home with me, as a reminder of how the indiscretion of seeing too much could only result in incapacitation and removal of the organ of vision. But I could hear still and smell, and that came to plague them with new fears, for hearing what was not authorized to be heard and smelling events and incidents when to a normal nose no such odor was detectable was clearly a sign of some disorder, an alarming derangement of the senses that needed to be fixed. Thus they removed the olfactory receptors to begin with, and with one stroke they also killed the sense of taste, before they turned their attention to the faculty of hearing. Some joker suggested that while I was in their power, they might as well cut off my ears. That done, they pierced through the tympanic membrane, through the ossicles in the middle ear, right into the cochlea, and drained it of all its fluid. Then they let me go, but my feet were unsteady, and I could barely walk. So this time they did not provide a jar with pickled water to carry with me the ears that they had lopped off. It seemed, however, that the wagging tongue, though it had difficulty making words, still troubled them. A day later, I was called back, and just as a matter of preemptive caution, that tongue was sliced off. Take that, they said. You should be safe now, from yourself and us. Now all I have left is touch, this body, and what it feels on its skin, and touch clothes and flowers in the dark. Touch my cheek and see how it burns and softens. Pass your hand over my chest, and suddenly under your palm it responds. The nipples stiffen, the flat stomach twitches, and the hair, oh, but hair vanishes under the palps of your fingers and the hollow of your palm. And before you know it, the chest swells and grows breasts, soft and firm at the same time, urgent for recognition. You move down the body, the hips, lean at first and slim, begin to round out and ease a bit, pliant and elastic. In the middle, The penis, like a piece cut from a stem of sugarcane in a clump, recedes and retreats under your fingers, becomes a clitoris, nestled in the sanctuary of the vagina. And down, down further, the muscle thighs and shanks turn and transform, smooth and sleek under your touch. And the feet are the feet now, fleshy though strong, that they never were. A wondrous transfiguration, a metamorphosis like never seen before, but at the beginning, the very beginning of all things. They would have liked to kill me. But who would clean their bathrooms and their kitchens? Who would till the soil and plant and harvest the crops for them? Who would nurture the orchards with their sweat and pick out the best of fruits for them? And who would do their menial work? Bring up and teach their children, fight their battles for them. Sans eyes, sans ears, sans tongue, bereft of sense of smell, I am all body, I am all touch, I am all feeling. And even this scares them. They would have to kill me entirely for me to stop articulating myself through touch, or disable my brain completely for the body to not transmit its signals of pleasure and joy and protest. But what use would I be then for them? Words flow out of my hands now. Words pour out of my fingertips. Touch becomes feelings, becomes thought, becomes tongue. They try to pass laws to forbid feeling. Touch frightens them now. They wish to forbid touch. The body frightens them. They wish bodies wouldn't join, wouldn't bind, wouldn't interfuse. But they are helpless now. The body finds its language. The body expresses itself.
A couple of short poems.
It's an age-old form that I wrote in some of poems. Maybe all of my poems are quirky, but this one in particular. It's the villainal form that I wrote this one in, so I would like to share this poem with you. Unlike the other one, this is a short poem, and this is called The Tea Party. This is the reference to the Boston Tea Party. You'll make it out from the poem itself. A lot of tea was tossed on fish that day. They would have come in pumps and heels and hats if only they were asked or had a say. But no one had a thought for them that day. The rebels railed against the Townshend Acts and just flung crates of tea in Boston Bay. Fish grumbled, indeed, this wasn't quite the way, darting away from staining tea leaf tracts, if only they were asked or had a say. Above, roused comrades rushed without delay to teach a lesson to Westminster rats, tossed yet more tea on fish in Boston Bay. Caught by surprise, fish stared in dismay as writers trained to profit plutocrats, if only they were asked or had a say. So without a tea or milk pot or a tray, without scones, crumpets, biscuits, butter pats, a lot of tea was dumped on fish that day, if only they were asked or had a say. Another poem, this is by request. This is, if some of you might remember, the very famous composition by Wajid Ali Shah, Babul Moran Nayar Chuta Jai. So this is not a literal translation of that. This is inspired by that, rendered through that. It's called Unclassified Eye. There's some Bulle Shah here too, by the way. Unclassified Eye. Unclassified eye, neither one nor its other, from sea nor sand, river nor land. Father, my home I leave behind. Mother, this knot I now unbind. My days of play in your backyard over, your threshold strange like a mountain range. Days of laughter left on stone, a shadow of vanished flesh and bone. Four carriers adorn my traveling litter, and bear it upon shoulders that glitter. My very own and those unknown recede slowly from my lingering eye. Man nor woman, beast nor snake, fish nor fowl, real nor fake. Father, keep your home. It was not meant for me. I leave now for a far country. And this is the last poem I will read for you. It's a poem that I read at another session too, but I'm reading it because this book is dedicated to the person to whom this poem also is dedicated. This is Eric Garner, who was this African-American person, anonymous person, before the police caught him in a chokehold and killed him. Police violence against blacks is rampant in the United States, but it's also against Hispanics, and increasingly find it is against people from the subcontinent, whether India or Pakistan or Bangladesh. Everyone is believed to be a Muslim because their color looks the same. So we have a remarkably civilized country that judges people only on the color of their skin and not on the content of their character or their beliefs, whatever it is. A breath, a word for Eric Garner. One word to share with you. One breath between us. One word I could not utter. One breath stuck in my throat. My body's grime is all my wealth. You excavate me to find yours. I was a child without a childhood, a young man without his youth. My gentleness denied taught me to love, and love taught me to invent a life. But my body's grime could not be washed. My body's grime would not let me live. Ek saans hai, ek lafz, aapke saath baantne ke liye. I can't breathe, I can't breathe. Ek lafz jo keh na saka, I can't breathe, I can't breathe. Ek saans jo le na saka, I can't breathe, I can't breathe. Mere jism ki mail hi mera kul asasa hai. I can't breathe, I can't breathe. Aap mere jism ki kaan ko khod kar apne asase banate hain. I can't breathe, I can't breathe. Ek saans hai, ek lafz, aapke saath baantne ke liye. I can't breathe. Thank you.
Okay, so now we have Haris Khalique.
Thank you very much, Ilona, and hi, Blaine. Ladies and gentlemen, how much time do I have, Ilona?
Seven minutes.
Okay. So you have to time keep. Okay. This poem is these are new poems. This one is titled "The Palm Reader of Aleppo." Slowly, the evening began to descend upon Aleppo. No one survived in the neighborhood, but the palm reader. He had squeezed himself under a large trunk of fresh potatoes when they came and opened fire. It was indiscriminate. After they left, he stepped out of the house to find himself alone amid fresh corpses, in the streets and on the door sills. The corpses will remain scattered until the next day. Since the neighborhood was cordoned, the enormity of death made him indifferent. He felt hungry and walked back home, took out some potatoes, boiled them unpeeled, sprinkled some salt on them, ate to his heart's fill. Bored with nothing to feel and nothing to do, he slipped a small torch in his pocket, stepped out of the house again. He decided to read the palms of dead people. That will take him through the evening and the night. So many palms to read and no fortunes to tell. The magician and the boy from Waziristan. This is the title of the poem. The Magician and the Boy from Waziristan. It was a stony winter morning covered in mist. The half-awake magician answered the hurried knock at the front door. The boy, covered in dust and smell, carried a big, bulky sack on his back. It was made of coarse jute threads tightly interwoven. A thin and flexible but armored metal strip looped around the mouth of the sack to seal it. The boy looked straight into the magician's eyes. "I come from far. I remember watching you in the circus with my father. You had cut a woman in half, then joined her back. They were all burned to death after the bomb went off. Only my mother's body is not charred. I bring her to you. She's only cut in half." The juggler and the spy. The juggler was scorned by the spy, for the audience loved his tricks more than the truths uncovered by the spy. So one day, the juggler found his props missing. He had a sight swap show. Stalls were ready. Tickets were sold, microphones mounted, spotlights fixed. Restive, the juggler paced up and down the backstage until his calves turned into clubs. His bust morphed into a diabolo. His fingers changed into devil sticks. The juggler became the props himself. The trickster became the trick. The spy remained the spy. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, I think Mehvash. So Mehvash Amin, I just wanted to mention that she has just published the ILF review, yeah, which is being launched tomorrow. And she's also a very fine poet.
Thank you. Okay, so I hope you all get a copy of the ILF review. And this poem is about birds and car journeys. Sorry, I forgot to put my glasses on.
You need to bring the mic down as well.
Okay. Right here. It is 6 o'clock. The mosque dome cups its hand to the sky. Journey speed makes an opaque landscape sham transparency, reducing obese trees to screaming lines of hushed green, and spreading my jellied thoughts like jam over the rushing miles. Catenaries dip aluminium loops about a Ulyssian cloud head, a mind head born of mind patter. It follows rain sound, but there is no rain. Then sudden crows, silently picking the brains of telephone poles, turn antimony profiles to the sun and cut into my evolving poem with the keenness of laser beams. Another time, as I sit at the back of a car reading Ben Okri, the traffic slows, then stops. An eagle swoops down to snatch a pedestrian's food and rises like a victorious gladiator above its cowering victim. Yet another one descends, and another. This is a game that they seem to like, making cowards of men in steel chariots. Years later, passing a deserted plot at dusk, I see a brown cloud of mousy house sparrows lift off with alarm clock alacrity, as if remembering an ancient oath to some terrifying day god. These aerial creatures borrow their insolvency from ancient marsh light, in which they witnessed the tense coupling of dinosaurs, straining to live, yet sworn to die. Mythic, almost hermaphroditic, they are winged with enough of the before and after to raise a dust trail of history and suggest the sluggish stirrings of future life. The second poem is about Islamabad. This was just published in the Asia Literary Review. It was written a few years ago, so it does not talk about it as it is now, but as it when the Taliban was supposed to be 100 miles away. There are the gentrified mountains, not enough to unsettle, no, but enough to be a logical foil for the gleaming city construed for a new nation. Climb then, and you see it spread eagle its green grid all the way to the lake, beyond the broom and smoke of progress. They're clawing out dark earth to make way for a new metro, after all. I think of decades ago, when I used to trek up here and cycle on the smooth tarmac of new roads. I also remember heartache and the loss that destroyed the neatness of geometry and grids, pummeled order into an ordinary chaos. Beyond that, memories of my parents taking me home as the street lights dipped and rose luminously, the visible path of a heavenly comet, a child's imagination enmeshed with sleep. Then a new house on the same road as the field marshal's and seeing his handsome face rise balloon-like over the high wall of his estate. He had built his garden above ground level, you see, so he trod a higher earth than us. Well, naturally, he had been president. Tales of fire and brimstone singeing the sky when the army ammunition dumps spit out death, cancelling out lives there, but here simply torpedoing a steel dolphin into our garden. It chose not to explode with the desultory casualness of fate. Twin towers fell elsewhere, and journalists rooting in the lobby of a hotel rushed to the rooftop when it was time to pitch practice stories. Later, that same hotel would explode, shockwaves sculpting plastics into furious artworks of destruction, extending the clever skills to our house to morph glass into jagged waterfalls and doorknobs into missiles. Too soon, our city became another city, loops of wire crisping its horizon, painted barricades brutalizing its roads insistently. Afghans who had hawked lapis and silver and wondrous kilims by the stream were herded off to their camps. Grenades were tossed into smart restaurants, and diplomats went deep into fortified enclaves. That innocence of a new city that should have fetched hope fought off doom instead, its encircled cancer spreading sly shoots beyond. What happened in the city did not stay in the city, we all knew. Still, every time I ascend from my new home in the plains to my hometown, every time the blue mountains into which the aircraft had slammed rise like some stone memory, my heart rekindles joysticks of old loves, and I wait to be returned to that house on the hill, amidst poplars. City of hope, city of embers, my city.
Hi. Before I begin, on behalf of all the poets gathered here, I'd like to thank Ilona Yusuf for organizing this poetry recitation for three consecutive years now. So a quick round of, and it's really encouraging to see so many people in the audience, especially when we are competing with the Urdu Mashaira happening at the same time.
I forgot to say that this is Waqas Naeem.
My name is Waqas Naeem, by the way. I have three short poems. The first one is titled, A New Grief. All night, a cat cries outside my window. I have curtains drawn always. There is no vision. Only the sound travels, unwelcome and violently unstoppable, as if it was made of a new grief for a new cold heart. The second one is titled Everything's All Right, and it's after the Pakistani-born British poet and artist Imtiaz Dharkar. RIU-7486 is no ordinary rickshaw. At its heart is a magnet, a black hole that pulls motorcycles out of orbit, sucks them in, and rips them apart. Spoke by metal spoke, each cog, screw, drop of petrol, pipe, all industrial efficiency reduced to stardust, or so I believe. Is death less scary if you are prepared for it? Seems like a question passengers of this rickshaw might ask. Is death less scary if you are prepared for it? If you know when it'll happen? It terrifies me, and I shrink so small in the back right corner of RIU 7486, I am certain accidents will fly by. The face of Razik, the rickshaw driver, appears creaseless in the side view mirror. His composure is a halo that lights the insides of this rickshaw. Some revelation is at hand, of what I am not sure, and I've never been more uncomfortable. Razik's elbow shifts, his wrist slides. We have skipped three lanes and several of my heartbeats. The red signal melts into savage beeps when he raises the wick and teases the moths. He strays too close to create disorder and makes it personal. This might still be a black hole. Somewhere between Sadr and Kacheri, I see a car side us. The left wheel catches air. The right burns into our destinies. We are tipping over. Slowly, I get up, kneel, and push the rickshaw frame back with both hands. In the side view, I catch Razik's eyes. He laughs and says, "You're crazy, you'll kill us." This final poem is titled, "The Music is Always On," and it goes something like this. At 6:50 p.m., I turn the music on in my room and leave. The dance is in the streets. A couple sits on a park bench. A taxi driver waits outside. Young men play basketball before the rains could flood the court again. Two boys share a bicycle ride and joke about getting run over by a truck and how it would be no one's fault and everyone's. The full moon has blossomed even before the sunset prayers are over. The worshippers pour out past sputtering motorcycles. A 14-year-old sells me smokes. Nearby, two drivers begin a fight over backing up, and our evening entertainment is settled. A dog collapses on discarded cardboard, and just like that, the weight of someone's war buries us all. Thank you.
Okay, Azka. So, Azka Khan.
I have four poems. The first one that I'm going to read, I generally conduct a Facebook poll when I have to read my book poems out. And then I just read, you know, it's very democratic. So I'm going to start with a poem that's old. It's 3 years old. And it's called Conversations About Love with the Therapist. One, I was careful. I had love songs in one hand, and mothers, love's a myth men made to trick their way into women's pants in the other. From Chaucer to Siegel, imagine a grand conspiracy. And mother won the night I learned men and their appetites have little to do with love songs. Just how men are, my love, just how men are. I put my love songs away, read advice columns, burned all my fingers so he could come home to the smell of freshly baked cookies. He watched the same headlines all day, and I heard love songs hum behind kitchen cupboards. No, I will love him. By God, I will. And he will learn to sing. Two, aurat hi badalti hai. And so I let him rewrite me. The roof over my head, his. The child that came from me, his. The flour and brown sugar, his. Why must I belong to myself? But he liked his girls, softer here, firmer there. painted pictures over our bedroom ceiling to illustrate how wrong I was in having such countable ribs. Just how men are, my love. 3, I was careful. I wrapped my revolution in chadar and char divari, ricocheted between one and the other, dawn till dusk. Nights he was hungry, I made to-do lists in my head and counted shadows. But I still heard just how men are. And the silence of love songs over the sirens in my head, through clenched teeth, balled up fists, and hush. The roof over your head, his, your jagged little body, his. The night is dark enough without the curse of 40 angels. There are things I know I never set out to know. 4, I am careful. Though some days I want blade in one hand, blood in the other, but only to tear out this tumor, latch deep, feeding inside me, swollen with age-old rhetoric. We can use fancy words here, doctor, but out in the real world, there are mothers telling bruised, scarred, burned, terrified daughters, go back to him. This is how they love. This is how your father loved.
Thank you. I'm going to, the next poem I'm reading out, for Jerry, who would probably be here if he wasn't in Australia. And it starts with 3 lines from Adrian Rich's Snapshots of a Daughter-in-Law, which I'll read out first. You all die at 15, said Diderot, and turn part legend, part convention, still eyes inaccurately dream. This poem is called Backspace. It's a syllabic poem, so it's 10 syllables in each. I was experimenting with this. And on my desktop, in plain sight, is a file. Poems to work on or do away with. Click open, scroll down, highlight, copy, paste. Document 1 has me transfixed, running through my head ticker-like. If only she applied herself. Damn it, focus. 2 more, has a flair for writing. Faded 5th grade report card, still here, somewhere. Where was I going with this? Backspace, blank page, waiting. I can be anything. Count syllables, like chalk marks on prison walls measuring time. 1 for every year since that evening. They saw, then marked me, yours. And you, above these matters, merely nodded your consent. I cannot separate, start, middle, end. But what will you write if you killed yourself? I would never have thought something you said could fit so perfectly here. Let's start there, under the maple trees of your summer home, our sun on the swings in the corner of my eye. These are the things that I would write, and I'd sign them still alive. This poem, this is work in progress, and I'm very nervous about reading this out. It's called, Who Do You Belong To? I will have them trace your bloodline back to this body that has housed both our hearts. Now, kick the walls until your play has you tangled twice in umbilical cord. I spend all afternoon on mother's rug, breath held, counting every move. 1, 2, 3, and push. Your heartbeat dipping each time as if you want to stay. And you do, until they have to cut me open to draw you out. You have arrived. Now, cry. In these arms, your skin stained still in my blood. Who do you belong to now? past seven, still in my arms, you say, "Was I in your tummy before, Mama?" "Yes." "What happened to you then?" I touch your nose, your meteor dust freckles, your hair bronze in the changing light, heart beating in my hand, and listen for the clamor of courtrooms, clause upon clause, till we are lost in paperwork, and thud, thud, thud. These chambers echo with you, God. Even God, when all this has passed, will call you by my name. And yet, who do you belong to? I'm going to end with the shortest poem I've ever written. It's called Why They Fear Us, and it's come from just being a woman in this country. Astaghfirullah, for every inch between a woman's heel and the rim of her cigarette pants riding up, there are signs of the end of times in every nook and cranny of her narrow frame. But she shrugs, unaware, and there are tremors elsewhere, all 7.6 on the Richter scale traced back to these ankles. Even last year's floods were conceived here, breathed their first under her red toenails, and were set free when one day she laughed too loud and a man across the street paused to imagine her mouth. Thank you.
Risham?
Risham Amjad.
Hi, everyone. Wow, it's quite a thing to follow Azka after those poems. I'm a final year student of economics, and I write poetry in my spare time, if there is any. Recently, I started doing GloPoWriMo, which is Global Poetry Writing Month. So you pledge to write one poem for every single day of April. So 30 days of poems for April. I am already very far behind. But I did manage to write one poem. And the prompt of the day was write about something mundane. And this is, I suppose, very mundane for women in this country. Fazilat comes once a month and brings her mother-in-law's recipe for hot wax and plays conversational catch-up. On Sundays, she smells of church bells and incense and penance from confession. Her presence sounds like denim whip cracks and muffled gasps in closed rooms. Fazilat comes once a month, like her name, a blessing. Women part with money for trouble ripped out by the roots, sore arms and underarms and legs, but now I'm not supposed to feel shame. New little girls each time taught shame for hair their brothers wear too. Fazilat never comes some weeks, but always before a marriage. Ritual, preparation, repentance, we're never told. Her livelihood paid in full by rules no woman ever wrote. Fazilat comes once a month, more tired each time. Her eyes, she tells me, grow weaker, and that she just went to get fitted for spectacles. She's been straining to see how our hair is different from their hair. And this is a slightly longer poem. It's I ended up writing, this sort of ended up becoming a spoken word poem, so it's very rhythmic and rhymes quite a bit. And the context of this is, in 2015, Kate Middleton and Prince William came to India, and there were all these receptions for them, and they were hosted by a number of very famous, very accomplished Indians, and I remember thinking of how they seemed in awe of them, and they spoke in accents, and they were very, you know, impressed by them still. And it's sort of, this poem is sort of a meditation on how that made me feel. It's called Mother Tongue. Bowing and scraping should commence promptly at 8. Never initiate physical contact with skin that's every after picture from Fair and Lovely ads. do not speak unless spoken to in their Eton Harrow voices, with Queen's English clipped vowels that can't seem to roll off our rhotic tongues. Tonight, 1947 doesn't seem to have changed a thing. Speeches are made in accented English, and because their flag once waved upon the colonized shores of your vocal cords, the shape of your mouth changes and spines align to show them, oh yes, you have made good the sacrifices of hallowed names and bloody bogs and body bag trains. You lift champagne and canapes with brown hands, lick puff pastry crumbs and guttural consonants away from the partition between an upper lip made stiff through received pronunciation and a lower lip made of mother tongue. And the spot of bother with the no dogs or Indians allowed signs and that petty little land dispute is well in the past as your socked feet shuffle eagerly down special security clearance lines because you are a Commonwealth convict, chosen at random for strip searching. Your name is butchered many times over. And when immigration officers ask, what is the purpose of your visit? You answer, to strip the brown from my skin, my tongue, my passport. Will you, their suspicious blue eyes ask, try to make away with the wealth we took from you? Is the Kohinoor safe from the smelly oil that gleams on your dark native hair? We are more than lines on a map 200 years in the making. India and Pakistan and what was once Hindustan. The bigger war is the one we wage on the battlefields balanced inside our mouths, tipping precariously every time our tongues twist and fake accents find their way out. Colonization has never quite managed to crawl out of our minds or our mouths. We are never quite white enough, never quite good enough. And the last poem is a very short poem, and it's about car journeys. I wrote a series of poems about being in cars, and this is a shorter one. Billy Joel fits between the spaces of our Sunday, like playing the silence-bridging music notes. They broke a mountain to drive a road through it. Now it only takes four songs instead of an album to cross the city. I remember when the roads were shorter and our journeys longer. Quiet would fill the car, the fifth passenger left behind in the temporary blindfold of the darkness between one streetlight and the next. We were left alone. Thank you.
Orooj Zafar.
Can everyone hear me? All right, assalamu alaikum everyone. This is my first ILF and I'm terribly nervous. But to introduce myself, I'm a third year medical student at Shifa. And my full-time non-paying job is being a spoken word poet. So I generally memorize my poems because I like making eye contact with people when I recite poems, but this is an exception. So the first poem I'd like to read out to you is it's kind of how I introduce myself to people when they ask how long I've been writing. This is called Birthmarks. My father kissed me in the womb right where my palm meets my left pinky. My July cousin and I fell on the same patch of heaven's grass on the same leg and branded ourselves with the same cylindrical melanin scar. I have five dimples and two raindrops making quiet room on my smiling upper lip, the only birthmark my canvas of a body hasn't housed yet are the words my grandfather found when his wife needed to see heaven's gates for the second time. I don't say it for the sake of poetry, but when she was gone, he cried so much his eyes clogged with cataracts. His body exhumed the fact that her cold bedside was a part of the family now. I have written nothing about the time he left me, how writing was a pipe dream rusting under the breath of his wife and four children until his depression clenched his chest so hard his mind begged for air. He forgot his wife and four children for 7 days. Writing brought them back. He could not bear to lose them in his head yet. Years that followed turned his bedroom into an office, his plastic table stacked with photographs, handwritten pages until leather bound. I remember his frail hands clasping a pair of yellow scissors, eyes scrunched in absolute focus with the keenness closest to an empty bedside. He taught me what real loss looks like, what fear would sound like if it opened its doors to love, banging for dear life. He gave me my heart, my words. See, if I sit still for too long, I confuse my pulse for earthquakes. This is the birthmark my grandfather gave me. When I rubbed his cold feet as he let his last breath go, he left his love for ghazals in my throat, his thirst for stranger stories in my ears, his beating heart echoing still in the corridors of my body. Sometimes, when I wake up in the middle of the night, my knees shake, toes twitch. It takes a while for me to realize it isn't another earthquake. The next poem is called The Gum Tree Womb. I wrote it for my mother because I generally don't write poems about family members, so you guys are lucky to experience this. Okay, The Gum Tree Womb. The Gum Tree Womb for my mother. She says her gum tree hands are not young anymore, and I want to tie their barks together when she prostrates to show her our God has just loved her longer. I want to show her how humans scarred mine because I didn't keep signs up saying, beware, this forest is breathing. Just the sight of her warrants a search for air. Her own earth scent is charged without need for turbulence. You'll know it's her from the sound of her trees growing as loud as she is quiet. Her chorus is unmistakable pride because she swept her unwalked floor for deceit, twigs for thorns, leaves for too much safety, veins beaten silver in her own image. You cannot pinpoint her Ouroboros. Her reflection is three shoots aiming through a canopy of green for so much more than just the moon. She doesn't ask us to look for God anywhere outside the radius of home. The gum tree is a gnarled temple we happened to every leap year after the end. The last poem I wrote, it's been over a year since I wrote this, but I think every time tragedy hits, there's this ritual that my mother and I share. Something bad happens on TV and I look at her and she literally just like shakes her head and she says, we're not going anywhere, we're going to stay here. I hope the poem explains that. This is called Soil Cracks for the Mothers. The women in my family only hear kettle whistles instead of street calling. Our tragedies have grown their own spines. They have become lost vertebrae. No one taught us to stand taller than this. When home is a bullet-shattered windscreen, we don't talk about it. We know leaving bloodied soil is cowardice. If a child cannot feel safe holding mosaic hands, staying is our penance. Our grandparents bore fruit for the graveyard, now oscillating shadows on the burial ground. We cannot leave any one of us behind. Blood is lost control once it breaks skin, so our women are more bruised than wound. We have more skin than we need. We are part bone as compensation. The women in my family have never wasted a lentil, brushed every hair in sight. Everything touching the earth has its place, even when men come for us. When they do, we are not phoenixes. We are not scaled mermaid skin. We are fruit not yet lashed to its core or stretched out for sustenance. My women are all spine and tongues that rip through the air like truth seeing daylight for the first time. We do not resist the earth, the only mother we forgive for taking. Thank you.
Thank you, all of you. And now it's my turn. So this one is called Orooj. Can you hear me? The Khanpur Orooj is thin-skinned, a finely indented oval tapering to a narrowed peak tinted with a maroon blush. Inside, each segment sheer as paper silk, stitched with drops of living red. That first piercing, the crescent of a nail, the tip of a knife, releasing a fine, stinging spray, trailing a scent of orange blossom and a fine trace of oil on the finger. It's hard to find true Khanpur oranges now. Ripening under cold's deep kiss, the season's short, and they're shipped to less exotic climes, prized for the flavor that bursts, then lingers in the mouth like perfume. A foreign friend returned two winters for them. I began with something else, though. I'm not sure now what it was, because I began with a memory of peeling oranges, Khanpur oranges. I think the key was light. Light as it pools on three oranges, here, now, making their skin, that maroon blush, more luminous against the shade around them, in a colored straw basket, tight woven, geometric. As I peeled them for my children on winter nights, light pooled warm on their faces. But now there is constant sound beside the basket, tight woven, geometric, like that large basket from winter nights long ago. The television spewing voices, as the warning drone around a vespiary, relentless, edged with frenzy, chronicling death, listing strife. The second poem is called Limestone, and I write a lot about rocks and limestone in particular because I like it, and I enjoy when we drive on the motorway, then my favorite part is through Kalar Kahar. But as I said, partly because I love limestone and anywhere in the world. So limestone. Not the hard, compacted fists of rock formed of fire, high shined in water, but permeable grain. I'm still not sure why I like it. Like it? I'm fascinated by it. Perhaps because it's formed from life, slow flattened beneath the weight of water, milfae that carry the stamp of bone, liquid congealed, the soft whispers of life's exhalations. Then slices thrown up, sharp slammed, folds crisscrossing, splitting in shaly flat fragments, or conglomerations, stones pressed together, honeycombed with nodules, fissures, elongations, where waters melted rock to take its flowing shape, then settled in hidden pools, channels, and something else too, luminosity beneath light, as if rock's embedded memory of life's lit from within. Thank you. I don't know if we still have time. Okay. One more round?
You can read a few more.
I think everybody could read something, or as many as can go.
We can hear from Blaine and Dr. Waqas.
Okay. You have something?
I mean, they're just there. I mean, I would want them to.
Okay, who wants to go first? Being diplomatic or democratic.
I'll go first. And I'm going to read a poem about oranges as well.
Okay. Yeah.
I just have to find it here. Actually, Pakistan has wonderful oranges. In North America, we get what's called sun-kissed and navel oranges. We get some others like clementines and stuff like that. But I just discovered all the variety of oranges in Pakistan, and my favorite are kinu, and Malta. And I used to always go to a particular fruit seller to buy them, because he fascinated me. So this poem is called Kinu in Malta. Saib, Saib, the man in the turban, black as bark, his beard a bush in winter, shouts at me as if a matter of life and death. He stands among dry leaves spilled from the jacaranda that will burst in purple bruises in the spring. Come, come! With no warning, his fingers sneak to his hip, draw a crescent of precision steel from a leather sheath. He leans forward, picks up an orange, and slivers it open, juice spattering the air. Kinu, kinu, fresh, fresh. He brandishes fruit, the color the sun takes on as it falls low in the sky, distorts in December twilight. Malta, Malta too. Bitter rind runs crimson when it's slashed. Kinu, succulent segments compressed in their casing, when released, are sweetness on the tongue, the couplets of guzzles that mingle astringent pain with aromatic love. Malta, concentrated tartness, dogmatic bitterness, blood that spills on the streets.
Okay, I will read out one, and it's a very old poem. I'll have to get it out of my phone. I was in Karachi recently, and I don't have a copy of my one and only book, since thereafter it's been mostly literary journals, and a friend of mine with whom I was staying had a copy, so I took some pictures. So I'm going to have to locate it. And the reason I'm reading it is because Maniza Shamsi was asking me today about my Polish heritage. So this poem has a bit of that. It's called Nostalgia. That famous Polish melancholy, symbolized in one untranslatable word, tęsknota, that to me is like wry, smiling sadness, angst perhaps, sadness through laughter, death in life, and most of all Chopin, whose tripping, fluid notes evoke the melodic fervor and feverish impulse of the Polish soul.
This is called Cuckoo Kore. Doves and horses, dumb birds and beasts, hoopoes and goats, come look, come look. Pigeons and cattle, rabbits and lizards, they're all for you. Run up and see. Here's a parrot with a hole in its neck, and if you blow through it, like this, see me do it. It's a whistle as well, blow hard or blow softly. It makes a sweet sound. Come try this one out. And so all these others have no sound of their own, but only what you give them by blowing through the hole. You give them your breath, you give them your voice. It's almost as if they stir in your hands. Clay toys shaped and molded and baked in a fire, clay doves and clay horses, each one just for you. A cart and its wheels with axle and spokes, an ox yoked to it, or a pair if you wish. There's more if you like, much more than all this. Let me untie this bundle and show you what else. Look, here a mud oven, all ready for use. Come close, you can touch it. It won't come apart. Pots, serving trays and saucers, clay skillets and pans, bowls, sifters, colanders, jars, dishes and spoons. Here's a pestle and a mortar to grind your spices and all that you can wish for. Take your pick or take it all. You just need a house. You just need a household. And everything to run it is here for the asking. And when you are done and tired of it all, you may toss these away without worry or care. Our mother, this earth, will take them all back, and rains wash and sweep them down rivers and creeks, into ponds and pools, into water holes and bogs, and again I will venture, as I have long done, forever and a day, through seasons and years, and dredge up the loam and the pitch and the clay, and once again knead it and mold it and sculpt it in forms that you see, in shapes that you love. Doves and horses, dumb birds and beasts, hoopoes and goats, I bring them to you. Pigeons and cattle, rabbits and lizards, they're all for you. Run up and see.
Could we request you to read Primer and perhaps give some?
No, let's have somebody else. Orooj,
you read one and then
Waqas,
who read Primer. Can we have 5 minutes extra if required? Thank you so much.
Okay, I'll just do the one. Yeah. All right. This next poem is from my book, which is coming out. It's a very short book. It's a chapbook coming out in July, hopefully, inshallah. It's called A brief introduction before this. I've noticed that when I was growing up, a lot of loud kids, a lot of hyper, as we like to call them, hyper kids would be like silenced and hushed and told them that their whatever they had to say was unimportant for the time being, because grown-ups were having more important, bigger conversations. So this is about just having friends who were loud, and being a loud child myself, I was a bit of a handful. So this is called Becoming Friends with the Sun. Back when crying was a sport my parents wished I didn't play, when my unlearned knees straightened right into walking, back then, elders marveled at my loud, my eyes barely open when they hushed. I was too busy making friends with the sun. What no one understood was to do something entirely impossible, say, make friends with the sun, I had to watch my breath and shout to the sky. In the following inevitable quiet, I listened. Soon, kids around me conjured aloud, much the same. They were alive, my every cell knew when it respired and gave in like theirs, growing like vines to our quiet sun. I was all roles, always missing the point of silence. At 6 months, from a loud sitter to a moving echo, bitter patter on tiled floors, my legs twitched until my mind flipped tables. I got moving, never quite comprehending how figures stopped. Luckily, rooms had walls, and my roles were immediate descendants of my amnion. I eventually became loud, like 14th of August that hasn't happened yet. Like 14th of August will keep happening 5 days later, like communication gaps, like furniture belting under my mother's need for change. Silence was always louder, taller from the corner of my eyes. Elders stared at the siren in my mother's arms. I was removed. My mother reads to me. I never stopped learning with my hands outstretched, nose diving into my new world, until books taught me color, wild like the sun, wild like my eyes, growing into their wonder. I listened. Elders were grateful until the story ended. Other kids joined. I was learning to love with my mouth open, and it was obscene. I was removed. My mother called to me. She read. I listened. I became again, softer than the last time, scorching in its weight. My voice now waits for a secret. It tries keeping its lips unparted. I hum my words, singing when asked to speak louder. In private, I learn to love with my mouth open again. My mother misses. She doesn't read to me anymore. She awaits, hands outstretched, eyes crunched against the winter sun. It is quiet. She listens. She listens for the crying. My lips touch. My voice still born when I breathe. Thank you.
remains. After the massacre, the night has fallen, moonless and dry. Let us collect the scattered body parts. It's easier, less painful, in the darkness of the sky. An arm cannot be made out from a leg, fingers from toes, a child's torso from a big man's thigh. But what about the head? A head is a head, whether living or dead. Thank you.
So on request, I said I'm reading primer or primer, depending on which side of the pond you belong to. But here we'll call it Qaeda or Al-Qaeda. Namu, Anu, Ninma, Brahma, Brahman, Rahman. Abraham, Ibrahim, Rahim, Abraham, Ram, Ram, Mara, Mari, Mary, Yesu, Issa, Masi, Yahweh, Yeshua, Yesu, Jesu, Jesus, Christ, Krishna, Krishma, Krishna, Radha, Radhe, Ram, Rab, Rabba, Abba, Ram, Sita, Sat, Satguru, Satnam, Ram, Lila, Lilith, Allat, La Ilaha, Aloha, Hashem, Il Allah, Lilla, Lila, Ram, Lila, La Ilaha, Elohim, Il Allah, Kalma, Kalima, Kalima, Ma.
We run out of time, and I think that's a beautiful note to end it on. Yeah.
Thank you all for being with us.
Thank you. This brings us to the end of the sessions today.